lift you up. I order my steps. Order my steps, Lord, so I can praise and magnify your righteous name. We praise and thank the Lord for the beautiful selections coming from the adult choir. At this time, we're going to ask you to stand to your feet as we present our preacher of the morning in the person of our own pastor, Bishop James Stuart Price. Lift your hands this way and say, Lord, 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 we ask for your word.
You may be seated. Praise the Lord, everybody. Praise the Lord again. We honor our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. I don't know about you guys, but I'm just thankful to be here today. I keep hearing the politicians. We're going to pass some laws. We're going to come up with gun controls, and it's going to stop all of the murders. Ain't going to happen. One reason, man is in control. Is man in control? Man is not in control. He seems to think he is, but my Bible tells me that things are going to get worse and worse. So when I read that and I hear them say what they say, I say, somebody's wrong. Where I'm looking at things right now, they're wrong. God is always has been right, always will be. So I'd rather put my trust in the Lord than in any man. And I'm believing God for deliverance, for healing, for whatever we need, I'm believing God. And I'm standing on his word. Giving honor to my wife today, who is my companion and my worker in the pulpit today. I thank God for her. To Mother Jackson, the president of the minister's staff. To Elder Shockley, our vice president. To all of the ministers in the house, to our mothers, our deacons, saints, and friends, and most of all, to the Most High God. There is none beside him, there is none with him. And when he wrote the book, or had the book written, he didn't leave nothing to chance. You can find no excuse in the word of God for sin. People seem to think you can live any kind of way, and God is saying, it's all right. You're going to go to heaven when you die. I can't find that in the word. So I rely on what the word says, and it says all sinners will be judged. And I don't know about you, but I just want to be right. Whatever it takes, I just want to be right. Whatever sacrifice I have to make, I just want to be right. So I'm praising the Lord for all that I am, all that I have, all that I'm trying to be in him, because I want to please him above all else. We're going to call your attention to the book of 1 Samuel. Elder Shockley preached Wednesday, and he was on it, but the Lord gave me some scriptures he used. Matter of fact, I believe it's the same scriptures, but he gave me another subject off of that topic. So 1 Samuel chapter 30. Verses 6 through 8. 1 Samuel chapter 30, verses 6 through 8. We ask you to stand to honor the word of God. And it reads, and David was greatly distressed, for the people spake of stoning him, because the soul of all of the people was grieved, every man for his sons and for his daughters. But David encouraged himself in the Lord his God. And David said to Abiathar, the priest, Ahimelech's son, I pray thee, bring me hither the ephod, and And Abiathar brought thither the ephod to David. And David inquired at the Lord, saying, shall I pursue after this troop? Shall I overtake them? And he answered me, pursue, for they shall surely overtake them and without fail recover all. I'm going to use for a subject. Encourage yourself in the Lord. Amen. precious Father, in your name, Jesus, we praise you. Lord Jesus, we see so much going on. We see so many failures. The suicide rate among our young people. When they've lost hope, they think death is the only deliverance. But death is just the beginning of an eternity. But Lord Jesus, if we know you, if we're connected with you, we can cast all of our cares on you because you care for us. And you are fully able to keep us from falling and to present us faultless. So we're going to just say, thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord, that whatever comes our way, we know we can make it through. We give you all of the praise, the honor, and the glory. If there be any sick in the house, speak a word right now. Let your healing take place. We ask it all in your mighty holy name. And all the people in the house say, amen. Amen. You may be seated. Encourage yourself. Now, we can't do anything in and of ourselves, but we must learn to put our trust in the Lord. We know that King David went through a lot, though some of it was his own making. But we don't want to talk about David today. We just want to tell you about the scripture of how David and his 600 men had defected from Israel and went to the Philistines because he was fleeing from King Saul. But when the Philistines became suspicious of David, they told him he couldn't go into battle with them, that they had to go back home to their own folk. That's where you're supposed to be anyway, with your own folk. We're supposed to be with one another. We ain't supposed to be out there wandering around and running from house to house and church to church and talking to some stuff that don't even make sense. But we're supposed to know the truth, because the Bible says, ye shall know the truth, and the truth shall make you free. Not let you be free, but will make you free. However, you must follow what the word says accordingly as it's written. We can't take it out of context to suit ourselves in the lifestyle that we want, but we got to follow after the things that God has put in order. Now, he gave Israel the law. The law was perfect. But we understand that because the law was perfect, man thought he was all right. But the law was a stopgap measure waiting for the coming of the Messiah. And things had to be put in order along the way. Sin had to be separated from righteousness, and the righteous people of God had to be identified with God. Now, God chose Israel and made them a nation that was not a nation. But we find that Israel, even though they were God's chosen people, just did not do things right. So the law was given for them to understand what God demanded of them. And even though this was written, and all they had to do was follow it. But God knew they weren't going to follow it. So the law was just temporary to let man know that he was a sinner. Without the law, there is no penalty. So when they had the law, they still tried to circumvent it all the way up to the New Testament, when we read about the priest, the Sadducees, the Pharisees, and how they would justify themselves by changing what the law said. One thing comes to mind real quick is the woman caught in the act of adultery. The woman? It was kind of hard for a woman to commit adultery by herself. But the Bible said, bring the man and the woman, and they're to be stoned. But here comes the Pharisees, bringing the woman. And I got kind of tickled when I was reading about it. And as I remember the story, they come and say, we caught this woman. Now, what are you going to do about it? Asking Jesus. Jesus just kneeled down and real calmly he said, let he who is without sin cast the first stone. Ooh, Lord. Well, there was some self-examination going on. So Jesus just kind of stooped down and written it right in the dust. See, when he looked up, but nobody left. What? Nobody left? They all were sinners. And Jesus went to the woman. He said, woman, go and sin no more. At least the worst thing come up on you. The Lord is always looking out for us. But I want to talk about Job. Job's situation was different from anybody else's. You can't find another episode in the Bible where anybody went through what Job went through. But when he went through it, God brought him out. Job, the Bible says, was a great man, a man that was perfect and upright, and one that feared God and eschewed evil. He was considered very rich, but he did not allow his riches to turn him away from God. He had 7 sons and 3 daughters. With all of his possessions, he was considered the greatest of all the men of the East. Remember, God said the same thing when Satan came too. The first thing to remember is when God is blessing, Satan is messing. Job offered sacrifices of burnt offerings just in case his kids had sinned and cursed God in their heart. Just when you think things are going fine, here comes the devil. Remember that Satan can only do what God allows. God, who has all power, knows how much we can bear. And we won't be tempted with more than we can bear. Encourage yourself in the Lord, because we have nothing to encourage ourselves with without the power of God. We want always to depend on God. That's what we should do. But we have a tendency when trouble comes to go to a friend. The warning I'm going to give you today about a friend. Bible says, know them that dwell among you. Whether you like to accept it or not, you know your friends, what they will or won't do. You know how much trust you can put in them. And I say this, that if they got a friend, if you got a friend, they got one. And unfortunately, every time something happens, when it gets back, it doesn't resemble what it started out to be. This is why we're told to put our trust in the Lord. When Job found out everything was going on, then all of a sudden, here comes Satan to God. Well, the only reason he's serving you is because you taking care of him, you got a fence around him, and I can't get to him. At least Satan acknowledged one thing. He had no power as long as God was shielding you from him. I'm so glad he does. So when things come, they're coming to set you straight with God. But unfortunately, we go through things, and sometimes we consider these things very severe. But I ask you to look at what Job went through compared to what you're going through. We all go through something. We are not, I don't care how long you've been saved. I don't care how long you've been walking with God. I don't care how much reading and praying you do. You are not exempt from suffering, temptation, or trouble. The Bible tells us that through much suffering we are made. Much suffering we are made. Now look what Job went through. All of a sudden, after Satan had gotten permission from God, God said, you can touch his things, but you can't touch his flesh. So what happened? He went in and he started killing off everything, killed Job's children. None of us have been through that. All 10 children. And then he had a wife who should have stood by him. And why are you going to maintain your integrity? You ought to curse God and die. We weren't brought to die. We were made to live. God said that he came that we might have life and have it more abundantly. So whatever is going on in our lives, we've got to learn to trust ourselves in the Lord. Then the friends, so-called friends, let's look at these 3 friends. Say they waited, they heard about Job's predicament. And I forget, let me add this part, he lost everything he had except his wife. The Bible doesn't give us much history. Don't even give us her name. Don't even give you the children's name. Don't give you the servants' names. But he said that these went through and his servants died, his children died, all of his riches were taken away from him. And when Satan had to go back a second time, said, well, you let me touch his stuff. Let me touch his flesh. The Lord said, well, you can do everything but killing. So the Bible tells us that he had boils. He was afflicted from his head to his feet. And Job was an elder in the nation. And he actually passed judgment. But when you think everything is going well, here comes Satan. We can understand and we can remember this. No matter how long you've been saved, Satan ain't went nowhere. He's still Satan, always has been, always will be. And the only time we can be away from him for eternity is when the Lord comes back to claim us as his own and remove us from this old world in which we live. Three friends said they heard about Job's predicament, and they decided that they were going to go to Job and mourn with him and sit with him and comfort him. Said when they got there, they didn't even recognize him. But what did they do? Sit down, and they said it was silent for 7 days and seven nights. Now, that was probably comforting to Job, but all of a sudden, here comes the first one. Let me give you the three names. Eliphaz, Bildad, Zophar. And each one of them took turns to condemn Job because he must have sinned. Now, bad things don't happen to you unless you sin. Let's don't get confused. You don't suffer because you sinned. Now, you may get chastised for something you did or did not do, but you don't suffer because of sin unless you commit sin. But when these things come, the Lord is just trying to tell us, I got your back. If you put your trust in me, I got your back. When David had this episode, he didn't trust in himself. Bible says David, when they threatened to stone him and do all of the things they were going to do, the Lord told him, he said, bring me that ephod. Let me talk to the Lord. Abiathar was the priest. And when he came, David consulted God. He didn't trust himself. Now, he had fought many battles, but he had not won all of those battles because of disobedience. And when they came, the Lord told him, said, go. See, this is why we got to trust God. The Lord told him, said, go. You're going to win the whole thing. The battle is yours this time. I'm going to defeat your enemies in front of you. So David, with 400 men, went and took back his family, his possessions. And the only thing he didn't get to do was go back to Ziklag, which is where they went out from. But Job's test was worse than that. He lost everything he had. He didn't have anything left. But when they got through, every time they would criticize, Job would defend himself. And he went through this, each one had two rounds of criticizing Job. A friend, the Bible said the friend is one that sticketh closer than a brother. So then would your brother talk to you the way they talked to him? Would you be treated the way he was treated? No, God wouldn't allow that to happen. But if we don't trust God, anything is subject to happen. But the Lord is fully able to deliver us, to bring us through every test, trial, and tribulation. Supposedly they had come to mourn, that's what they supposed to have done, and cheer Job up. But when they got through ripping him up, he was worse off. He began to bemoan his condition. And then he cried out to God to let him die. When trouble comes, encourage yourself. It won't be more than you can bear. I don't care what we're going through. It's not more than you can bear. We get a bad doctor's report, but what did God say? It won't be more than you can bear. We've got to learn through prayer and fasting to understand what God is trying to tell us. And he's telling us it's going to be all right. Just wait on the Lord. He will come to our rescue. Don't rely on man. Cast your care on the Lord, for he cares for you. Yes. Look at these friends. Friends now. We're talking about friends. Job, oh, you know you sin. Why don't you go on and confess it? Job said, I hadn't done anything wrong. And I was looking at Job last night, and I believe it's 28 chapters before God spoke to Job. And Job had complained to God. He complained to his so-called friends. And finally, after they gave up talking, God come and spoke to Job. Yes. Where were you when I laid the foundation? Where were you? He laid the foundation, opened up the way. What more can he do? It's up to us now to understand what God is looking for from us and do it the way he wants us to do it. If we don't follow the scripture, then we are not his. Trust in the Lord with all thine heart and lean not to thine own understanding. Yes. In all of your ways, acknowledge him. And he will, not maybe, could, should, he will direct your path. Yes. I trust God for my deliverance. Whatever I'm going through, it may hurt, but it's all right. I just want to stick and stay with the Lord. I want to hear from him. Because in due season, if I faint not, he will come to my rescue and deliver me from whatever I am going through. It don't matter what it looks like. It doesn't matter what anybody else says. What did God say? Keep your eyes on the prize. Yes. We're expecting to go back to be with the Lord, but if we're sitting down here bathing ourselves in sand and putting on sackcloth and ashes, and we're complaining, and oh, I just need a break, and I need this. Trust in the Lord. What did God say? I will never leave you nor forsake you. So no matter how hard the times look, how bad things look, what the devil is saying, and the devil is always going to continue talking. And the best thing you can do, don't engage him. What did Jesus tell him when he offered Jesus? Hey, look here, look out over here. See all this? I can give this to you. Give Jesus what? He owned everything. Jesus said one thing, get thee behind me, Satan. And that's what we're supposed to do. We're supposed to rebuke that rascal and tell him to get behind us, because God is in control. Look up, for your redemption draweth nigh. And if we realize this and we see the things going on, everything is lining up with the word of God. It's happening just like the Bible said it would. But we're told not to despair, not to give up, not to fall away, but to hold fast to that which we have. I will bless the Lord at all times. His praise shall continually be in my mouth. He's a bridge over troubled water. Lawyer in a courtroom. Doctor in a sick room. Whatever you need, God's got it. When trouble comes, submit yourselves therefore to God. Resist the devil, and he will flee from you. Draw nigh to God, and he will draw nigh unto you. So when things begin to happen, what's wrong with trusting God? What's wrong with depending on God? He made us who we are today. He gave us everything that we have. And if the Lord don't do it, it won't be done. He keeps the devil from overbearing us, from taking over us. And I've heard people say, the devil knows what it takes to get you back into sin. No, he don't. Don't you know that if he did, we wouldn't be saved today? God has put a barrier between us and him. He can only go so far. And the thing we got to remember, it's not more than we can bear. When we are sick, the Lord heals. When we need a nickel or a dime, he provides. When we need food on the table, he will give us what we need. He will open a door that people think is closed against us. We can receive blessings that we don't know where they even came from. I heard a lady say that, talking about getting her bills paid, said she had a bunch of toys and stuff on layaway. Somebody out of the clear blue came in, and for everybody, is that toys on layaway, they paid the bill. Who's greater than God? Who can open the door like God can? Who can make a way like the Lord can? Who can deliver us like the Lord can? Who has power over everything that we go through? Who has the ability to limit what comes our way? And the Lord said, and we know that all things work together for the good to them that love the Lord and are the called according to his purpose. But it's hard to understand sometimes that all things work together for good. All things? But Lord, I'm about to lose my job. All things? Lord, I've been diagnosed with this serious illness. It's working for your good. Sometimes how can you learn to praise God if you're not tempted in some way that you don't agree with? And I know one thing, I'll get you to call on the Lord and real quick. Oh, a pain hit you that you ain't never had before? Jesus! Oh, I hear that word in a minute. But he promised to deliver us. We got to hold fast to the things which we have. Believe God for the things which he's promised us. And wait for our deliverance. It's coming. Weeping may endure for a night, but joy. I said joy. You can't see joy right now. You can't feel joy right now. But joy. It don't look good, Lord, but joy. I don't understand why me, but joy. Hallelujah. The Lord will deliver no matter what we go through, no matter what it looks like, no matter what it seems like, no matter what's going on, God will deliver. Hallelujah. When trouble comes, stand in your place. When things don't look well, stand in a holy place. God is able to bring you out. God is able to open the door. God is able to close the door. When trouble looks like it's overflowing you, don't give up on God. Don't listen to folk that's supposed to be saved like you. Oh, when trouble comes, I just go to the lottery. Well, for what? You ain't got no money now. Why are you going to the lottery? The lottery can't deliver you. The only thing that can deliver you is the Lord and his gracious mercy, wisdom, and kindness, and his love for us. The Lord loved us so much that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him shall not perish. We are promised that we won't perish. All I want to do is be right. When I stand before the Lord, I just want to hear him say, well done. May not look good, but it is good. May not feel right, but it's all right. We may not understand it, but it's all right. But as song said, we'll understand it better by and by. Tempted and tried, we are oft made to wonder why it should be thus all the day long. Cheer up, my brother. Live in the sunshine. We'll understand it better by and by. Hallelujah. We'll understand it better by and by. Because God is my keeper. He is my shade upon my right hand. He will come to my rescue. I don't have to wonder what tomorrow's going to bring. If I see tomorrow, I'm in God's hand. And he will determine what tomorrow will be bringing. We can't change nothing. We can't fix it. But the Bible tells us, trust in the Lord with all thine heart. That's all we can do, trust in the Lord with all thine heart. Don't lean to your understanding. Don't ask somebody else, what does that mean? Ask God, why am I going through this? Because he said so. Because it's your time. You need to be awakened to the things that are happening around you. And we get comfortable in holiness. We get comfortable because there are times when we need to stop and pray. What the devil says, nah, you don't have to pray right now. Bible says you should always pray. You don't have to take 2 hours to pray every time. You can just say a word of prayer while you're driving along. If a thought comes to you, talk to the Lord about it. If you're going through something, talk to the Lord about it. He will, I guarantee you, he will deliver you in due season. Don't depend upon yourself. Don't be like Job. Allow them friends to come in and begin to accuse him. Who knows you better than God? If he allowed this thing to come, it's because he wants you to experience trouble. Don't you know you wouldn't serve God if you didn't have trouble? We would get so comfortable that we would stay home from church. We would work 7 days a week instead of six. We would seek things that we don't need and then wonder why it's not working. God is still God, always has been, always will be, and nothing will stop him from being God. We can give up on him, but he won't give up on us. He promised to never leave us nor forsake us. He told us that. Saints of God, Paul went through some things and Paul told us. Jesus said, be ye also ready for in a moment when ye think not. Paul talks about his afflictions. The apostles were killed, imprisoned, cast out into the outer place. All of the 12 passed on except John. John was cast out on an island by himself. But you know what that did for him? Gave him time to talk to the Lord. Gave him time to get some understanding of God's word. So what did he do for us? Left us the book of Revelation. And I read in that one part that I'm thinking about it. When all of these things have come to pass, what did he say? Even so, come Lord Jesus. I'm waiting. I don't know about you, but I'm waiting for the coming of the Lord. And I am determined to stick and stay. Go through. Stand to your feet, please. Encourage yourself in the Lord. Not friends.
Yes.
Friends are not always, they may love you, very close to you, will do what they can for you, but remember, they are not God. They are subject to things just like you are. Every child of God is going to go through something. If you don't believe me, just wait a while. We would like to offer prayer at this time to anybody that would like to have prayer. If you would like to have prayer, come on, ministers, if you can.